Okay, I guess we have enough members to start up with. So, good evening, everyone. I am Shantini Dev, the lead of Codecademy Siliguri, and I welcome you all to this event. Before we start, let me give a brief introduction of our guest speaker, Ms. Jasleen Sondhi. She will graduate this year with a triple major in physics, maths, and computer science from Mount Carmel College, Bangalore. She is a data science aspirant, a content writer, currently a beta student ambassador for Microsoft and the Codecademy Kolkata chapter lead. Her past experiences include an internship in SIRPI Data Science, mentor in Yay Celebrating Education, and the secretary of Physics Association of her college. Now let's welcome Ms. Jasleen to the Codecademy Siliguri chapter. And we are very honored to have you among us. Now the stage is all yours, Jasleen.
Hi, Shantini. Thank you so much for that wonderful introduction. Thank you, first of all, for inviting me to speak. And I can also see some of our other chapter leads have also joined. Hi, Sam. Hi, Joe. Thank you for joining. And yeah, I was going to introduce myself first, but Shantini did a great job. So I'll just move on to the main topic of today's event. Hi there. Yeah, so first of all, don't think of me as a professor or a teacher. Just think of me as someone who teaches you a concept right before you go into your exam, and that question comes in your exam and you're really happy. Think of me as that friend or that person. This is not a lecture, so I would like you all to interact as much as possible. Whatever I have learned throughout my journey in the last 3 years has been a mixture of self-learning and whatever I learned from other people. So take this opportunity to learn whatever I know, ask me questions, whatever doubts you have, however silly they might seem to you right now in your head, feel free to ask me, because you know, maybe there can be something I can supply you with that can help you overcome that self-doubt, and then you can also, you know, start off with your journey. That's really sweet of you, Sam, but I'm nowhere close. So yeah, I know it's 6:30, around 6. So if you're eating, if you're having your evening tea, that's fine. Bring it along, join us. And yeah, please feel free to ask questions, interact, unmute and ask whenever you feel the need. Yes, exactly. Just what Sanjog said, that can be done. So I'll quickly just share my screen. And maybe Sanjog or Shantini, you can confirm if it's properly visible.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. All right. I'll just share my screen. I hope my screen is visible.
Yeah, it's visible.
Yeah, it's visible.
All right. Thank you. So Shantini has already done a great job at introducing me, so I won't repeat that. In the end, I'll just drop in my contact details. So as you can see over here, I have mentored people in the past and I enjoy doing it as well. So I will be dropping my contact details. You can get in touch with me personally or you can join one of our communities, all of us. I'm running the Kolkata chapter just like Shantini is running the Siliguri chapter. So you can join that as well, or if you have friends in Calcutta who want to take up coding and want to learn and grow, you can refer them to me as well. So I'll just skip this introduction part and let's dive into the whole talk that is today, roadmap to becoming a successful programmer. So here basically is something what your day would look like if you decide to become a programmer at the end of your 4-year degree. If you decide to take up a development job or basically any computer science related job. So if you're someone who likes memes, well, can I have a show of agreement in the chat? How many of us enjoy our memes? How many of us like looking at them? How many of you have come across memes on programmers, computer science students? Okay, nice. So that's a lot of people who enjoy these memes, right? So yeah, us looking at memes on our own pain, that is humor based on my pain. And who can tell me which show is this from? The first meme.
Friends.
Yes, right, Friends. A lot of Friends fans here, right? Ah, I can see that in the chat. Nice. So yeah, basically you will be seeing a lot of memes on yourself. That's the first thing. The next thing, you will go out to take a job, but they will expect you to have some experience. But since you're a newbie, you won't have so much experience. But at the end, you need a little experience to get a job. So this talk today, I will try to help you with this, that since most of you are in your first year or second year, you still have a lot of time to build your skill set so that at the end of 4 years, you do not struggle with getting placed, getting good opportunities. And the third one is basically a lifestyle related meme that once you become a coder, you even start thinking of these concepts in your sleep. You sometimes get solutions doing the randomest things in your daily routine, maybe brushing your teeth, having your breakfast, and there will be this sudden, you know, idea popping, eureka moment that you'll be like, oh, okay, now I know how to fix this. And then you just abandon whatever you're doing and then go sit in front of your computer. So you can expect that to happen to yourself as well. The next one, being a real programmer seems very cool, very calm and composed kind of thing. People think we're so knowledgeable and we're so smart. We are, but again, sometimes we also need to look up the basics, and that's completely okay. Sometimes we cry out of frustration because our code might not work, but that's part of the job too. Yeah, so the last couple of ones, pretty self-explanatory. If your code compiles successfully, you are on top of the moon. You're really happy, you're really excited, and you're really proud of yourself because you made something and it's working seamlessly. That is a satisfaction that nothing else can replace. And then there are these common stereotypes that we have. Programmers are single, they use Linux, why do they use two monitors? A lot of people ask me that. Why do they prefer Macs? Why do they don't sleep at night? They code all night, things like that. If this is the kind of life that you want, I know it's a mixed bag, but the art of creating, the joy of creating something is irreplaceable. So this was just, from my end, a realistic outlook on what your life would look like once you've become a programmer. So that is what I was just trying to convey. Now we will follow I have prepared a PPT for you. So we will try to follow that. And then towards the end, I will be more interactive. I will list out a couple of other opportunities that are not really mainstream. And basically opportunities from my experience, how I found things, how I started getting opportunities, how I started to upskill myself. So this presentation, you can refer it to as a more formal way of how to grow as a programmer. And then the discussion that we are going to have towards the end, that will be more of my informal advice as your senior or as your colleague, which I would give you as you are just starting out. So during the presentation, if you have any questions, please feel free to stop me and ask. So I'm just going to start presenting. Okay, just a second. I'll just share my screen. While I do that, how many people has anyone been able to get vaccinated yet? In Odisha, maybe, because in Kolkata, I have been having a hard time finding a vaccination slot. How about over there?
Same in Darjeeling as well. It's very hard. Right now, the vaccine centers are running out of vaccines.
Mm-hmm. That's the thing. You know, we got to wait, we got to stay patient, and we got to book our slots like we are booking concert tickets so that they don't run out.
Exactly.
Okay, all right. I'll just reshare my screen. So I'll just put this in full screen. So basically, this is our topic for today, roadmap to become a successful programmer. So during my journey as a programmer, I started around 8th or 9th grade because we had somewhat easy basic Java coding in our school. So I started around 8th or 9th grade. Properly, I started around 11th grade because we started learning data structures and things like that. So during these, it has been around 6 or 7 years now. So what, at the end of these 7 years, I have realized is that you need small goals. You need something that you can time. You need something that you can actually achieve. Unrealistic goals never help anyone. So that's what this means. Specific, measurable, achievable, relevant, time-bound ways to become a good programmer. So it is very important to realize you cannot become this successful programmer in one day or in a year. It is a continuous process. It is to be continued even when you get a job, you get placed, maybe you start your own startup. You still have to continue learning every other day. So it is best to have small goals, measurable goals, goals that you can time. And at the end, when you actually achieve that goal, be sure to reward yourself in any small way, because that kind of motivation will take you in a really, really long way and help you in the long run. So don't expect to become really good in one day. That is the first thing I tell anyone who comes to me for programming advice. Do not expect to be really, really good on the first day or the first couple of weeks. So moving on. So this is basically how I have classified what we're going to talk about today. I'm going to start with the don'ts, because most people don't tell you the don'ts. You learn the don'ts the hard way. So since I have learned them the hard way, I would like you not to. So I would be going with those first. Then we're going to go for the do's. Then we're going to discuss the roadmap and career paths. And lastly, I'll talk about internships. So moving on. Let's start. So the don'ts, the first and foremost don't, that is even applicable to this session right now, is don't be afraid to ask questions. Curiosity is a really, really good adjective, good skill to have. And being able to transform that curiosity into questions, good questions, is also a really good skill. So being good at asking questions is something that you need first and foremost when you're starting out to become a programmer, because let's face it, there will be things you won't understand. There will be things you will have complications in. There will be things where you will be like, okay, why can't I do it this way when the textbook says it to do it that way, right? So during those confusing moments, keeping quiet will not help you. You have to ask. You have to ask the right person. You have to ask people who have knowledge about these things. And you have to make sure that you understand after asking those questions. So the earlier you develop this habit of asking questions, it could be your professors, your friends, your colleagues, your mentors, it could be anyone, the faster you'll gain confidence, because those doubts, if they keep piling up, they will never get sorted. They will definitely land you in trouble. So your goal should be that if you are coming across any doubt, any question that pops up in your mind, you have to get it clarified so that, you know, in the future, when you're working on the same thing, you never feel like, you know, I don't know this properly, or I am not sure how this works. That cannot happen when you're learning programming. So over here, you can take a look at what is an example of a bad question and what is an example of a good question. So a bad question over here, as you can see, it's basically someone telling them that, okay, I'm worried, this is not working, I don't know how to do it. That's what's going on over here. But a good question sounds something like, you know, I have checked the logs, I have, you know, tried to run it in this way, I have tried a different approach, but I have tried to use this other tool instead of the tool that I'm using, but it's still not working. What should I do next? That should be a good question. You should list out the steps you have taken so far. You should list out whatever, you know, your thought process is to solve that problem. And then you should be like, all of this hasn't worked yet. What do you think can work next? That is how you frame a good question. That is how you ask a good question. So that is my first and foremost tip. Never forget, keep asking questions. So I'm going to check in the end how many of you actually take my advice and ask questions in the end. Okay, next. These are pretty common ones, but again, they're pretty uncommon because no one in college or university will tell you these. It's only a personal mentor or a teacher who's going to tell you because they care for you. So don't be discouraged by errors or blockers. If you're seeing it, there is a chance that someone else has already experienced it as well. So one of the really, really good skills of a programmer is to know how to Google and how to read and post questions in Stack Overflow. Those are not familiar. Stack Overflow is a community, online community. Basically, you can go over there and ask questions. And there are people who are more experienced than you, or maybe who have faced a similar error than like you. They come and resolve your queries. So those who have never been on Stack Overflow before, I would really suggest you to do go and check it out after my session is over. So it's a really, really good platform. There is nothing like a stupid question over there. But posting a question on Stack Overflow also is an art, so you need to learn it. But once you master that, once you know how to Google the errors that you're facing, for example, if you're working in Python, you're getting this error on the bottom, error, there is some kind of type issue over here, and you don't know what that means. So the first thing that you should do is copy paste that error into Google, look at the results that are coming forward, try to make sense out of them before asking for help. So that should be your first step. Next, don't start blindly following any tutorial that you come across only to realize that it was really, really old or, you know, not really up to the mark of what you're looking for. So make a good choice when you are actually trying to learn online, because there is a lot of resources available. So go for the more reliable ones that have good ratings and that make more sense to you, because once you learn programming the wrong way, or maybe you started off in a way that makes you feel like programming is really, really difficult, you are bound to give up. So start with something easy, start with something that makes sense to you, that is easy to follow, easy to comprehend. Don't go by, you know, that my friend is doing this course, I should also do it. And when you start to do it, it doesn't make any sense to you. So don't do that. Make a custom choice, make an individual choice, use material that makes sense to you. That is all I'm trying to say. Next, don't compare yourselves to others and don't be discouraged if it took a week to follow a simple tutorial. That's how you learn. So just like I said, I started coding in school. Maybe you haven't. You started in college or you started 2 months ago. So that means our progress will be really, really different from each other. You cannot expect to be great as, you know, someone who's been coding for the last 15 years. I definitely cannot expect that, because obviously they have more practice. They will know more than me. So never compare your progress with them and never compare how much time it's taking you to learn, because you're in college, you still have time. You have a lot of time. And especially I know online classes have been like really chaotic these past few months. You feel like you're not really learning anything. So try at least, if you have time, like even half an hour a day of self-learning will get you a really long way. So don't compare yourself to someone who is studying 6 hours a day. Your 30 minutes is what matters to you. So focus on that. Next, this is the 1000 rule. So in my experience as a mentor, a lot of times I have had students come up to me and tell me, you know, ma'am, I don't think it is made for me. I don't know if I can do it. It's so difficult. I can't understand it. There are people who are so good at it naturally. And, you know, those kinds of self-doubt, that creeps in. But what I would like to tell you is that I was also that someone. I have an elder brother, he's an engineer. So he was really quick at grasping concepts. He was really, really good at computer science. He's 3 years older to me. So he was really, really fast and he was really, really good. And when I started off, I had a hard time. I had to learn everything down to the basic. I had to try out everything on my own. And I still felt somewhat unconfident because I was still learning. I had just started out. So, but he was naturally good at it. So that does not mean he is a better programmer than me or I am not really good. All it takes that the learning curve for everyone is different. So this 10,000 hour rule is basically quoted by Malcolm Gladwell in his book. It says practice makes perfect, in simpler words. You devote your 10,000 hours to any skill that you want to learn, be it painting, be it playing the violin, learning coding, building a game. You devote your hours, you practice, you devote your hours productively. You will be able to master it at the end of 10,000 hours. So that is what I'm trying to convey over here, that, you know, don't feel like you won't be ever good at it. At least give it your best, do it completely all the way. And yeah, first of all, obviously, if you're starting out, be sure that this is what you want to do. If not, there are a lot of career options right now, which are also equally good. So that does not mean that just because you have enrolled in a computer science degree, you have to get a computer science job at the end. There are a lot of upcoming divisions that are coming up. There's data science, artificial intelligence, blockchain, machine learning. They need computer science, but they don't, you know, it's not very conventional and traditional like we have in India. You don't have to be a software developer in so many words. You don't need to have that tag. You can learn other things as well. You can even go into marketing, digital marketing, content writing, other things as well. So first decide if this is what you want to do. And if you want to do this, then stick to the 10,000 hour rule. Try till the very end to master it. And I'm pretty sure halfway in that journey, you will be confident enough that, you know, okay, I think I can do it. I can make things. They're working. My code is working. And automatically, your curiosity to work longer hours will come in. You will automatically find yourself sitting at your computer trying to code more every day. So that was about the 10,000 hour rule. Now coming to the do's. Like I just mentioned in the previous slide, practice a lot. Coding is something that gets better with practice. You write efficient code every day, the more you practice. So start with the for loop, you know, then start learning how to make a function. After you make a function, start learning recursion. That's how it goes. So first and foremost, do is practice a lot. Practice every day if you can. So not only will this keep you motivated, it will also keep you in touch with the latest things that are happening. Next is explore all career paths before deciding on one thing. Don't be the, you know, conventional mindset that we have in our country that there's only one thing you can do, doctor, lawyer, engineer. Just like that, there in tech also, there is this concept that, you know, only SD1 people earn well, or the senior managers earn well. Data science and all is very risky right now. You should not try out that. There's no proper jobs. Don't go by that mindset. You explore, you have 4 long years. Explore everything that catches your attention, that you seem to like. And then, you know, once you're treading towards that final year, final semester, sitting for placements, in those 6 to 7 months, try to narrow down your choices. That, okay, maybe, you know, I am really good at data science, not as much as, you know, Java programming or other things. Maybe Python is more of my type of language. Python is something I'm really good at. Switch to that. Focus more on that. Try to look for opportunities in that field. Do not settle for, you know, just a 9-to-5 job where you will be dissatisfied. Go for a 9-to-5 job that you will enjoy every day. So next thing is, do break things down. You cannot learn everything all at once. It takes time. Use your 4 years wisely. Give it time. Give it smaller chunks of time. You don't need to code like 16 hours a day to learn it. Give it time. Give yourself time and learn. Next is, find a mentor. Mentor can be anyone, basically. You can, you know, reach out to your teammates, seniors in college, professors at college, even some of your friends who are doing good, maybe your siblings, or maybe someone who you come across on LinkedIn, you are really impressed by their profile, you like what they're doing with their work. Reach out to them, ask them, communicate with them. I'll get to this a little more towards the end. But yes, finding a mentor is a good thing to do initially itself, because that helps you to learn in a guided way. Next, we have, set some goals and push yourself. And I keep repeating this because, you know, I have seen people be dissatisfied with what they have ended up with. So explore several career paths before settling on one. These 4 years are for exploring. No one expects you to have an answer in the first year that I want to do this. I want to be a cloud engineer. I want to be a data engineer. I want to be a software developer. No one expects you to have those things. So do explore, learn a lot of skills, and then decide. Now we'll move on to something I personally list it as skills to know. So basically, these are a list of skills that if I am hiring someone, I would expect them to have it, right? And if you are someone who has these skills in your resume, I'm pretty sure you will be able to land any possible internship that you want as a college student. So let's take a look at these one by one. Number one is basic web development. Web development is nothing but how we make websites, right? So for that, we have HTML, CSS, JavaScript. So usually in our colleges, this is taught really late, probably in the second or third year, but it's really, really easy. It is not as difficult as it's made out to be. You can start learning this from first year as well. You can build your first website. Next is core programming. So you should be really good at least one of these languages. If C is your cup of tea, you can go for C. Just like for me, I learned Java in school, so I continued with Java. But since I am now going into the data science space, I have picked up Python. So I'm trying to get better at Python now. So at the end of 4 years, if you're good at any one of these languages, that is good enough for you. Next is designing. Designing right now is really important for just about everything, be it an app, be it a website, be it even posters for these events that we are having online. It can be, it's endless right now, and it's all digital. No one does it by hand anymore. So these are a couple of softwares. Adobe XD is for designing. It can, you can use it to design anything basically, but this is good for app development, app designs. Adobe Photoshop, again, Photoshop, I'm pretty sure most of you are aware. And there's Canva. So Photoshop is more, you know, you have to design the elements, but in Canva, there are a lot of free templates that you can use. So that way it is really good. Like this presentation as well, I have made it using Canva. So, excuse me. Learning Canva and how to navigate around it is also a good skill to have. Next, we have database management. So you can start with MySQL. What is database? How to, you know, what are the several commands? How to create a table, delete a table, update a table, basic things. Start with that. And then we have something called MongoDB. MongoDB is basically used for, you know, cloud storage and with websites and other things. So this is a more advanced concept. Start with MySQL. If you have got the hang of it, look this up. And then, you know, start to upskill in that domain. Next, we have cloud services. Cloud services in itself is a big topic, but it's upcoming. Cloud, I'm pretty sure most of you must have heard of the term cloud computing. Excuse me, yes. So cloud computing is also a really, really good field. So the current platforms that we use for cloud computing are AWS, Azure, and Google Cloud. So you can start off with any one of them, get to know the features, get to know how to create a virtual machine, get to know how to deploy resources, how to deploy your website or an app on these services. So it is good to know at least one of them, because most companies are using them. So if you're proficient in any one of them, you will be able to manage the rest of it. Next, I have listed out basic data structures. Data structures are basically how, you know, our programs, how our material data is being stored in the memory. So these are all the different types of data structures that you are expected to know as a computer science student. So again, these are also very, very vast in their own terms. So it's not like you have to learn all of them at one go. Pick up arrays, work on it for a few weeks, go to linked lists, again, take a couple of weeks, and similarly for the rest. And these are, like I said, this is just a rough, you know, outline of what would help you. So this is not something that you're just supposed to learn in 1 year, right, or 6 months. Take, I have written over here, one time period is around 1 to 2 years. You can even take 3 years of your college thing, you know, but at the end, if you have these skills, I'm pretty sure you will be better off, because that is what the industry demands. Sadly, what we are taught in our course is not really in accordance to the industry standards. And that is why most of us find it difficult to, you know, land opportunities and grow. So if you just know a couple of these, you will be, I'll show you how, you know, most of the job roles have these skills in common. So that is why I really swear by this list that I have come up with. So next is app development, understanding XML, APIs, and learning Android Studio. Android Studio is where you code the app. So that's another thing. And then lastly, it's Unix or Linux. Linux is another operating system, just like Windows. And then operating systems in their entirety as in how do they work, what are the scheduling algorithms, you know, how it all goes on behind the scenes. So it's good to have knowledge about that as a computer science student. And over here, if you can just take a look, I have mentioned two other things that can also help you that are not really expected. Version control system is basically Git and GitHub. So how many of you are aware of Git and GitHub and what does it do? Can I just have a response in the chat? Networks as in? What exactly do you mean by networks? Computer networks, is it? I don't even know this person's name. Okie dokie. Okay, Sanjok is aware of Git and GitHub. How about the others? Yes, okay. Okay, that's nice. Okay, about infrastructure. Yeah, that will more or less be covered in your college course. So for that, it's enough. But if you want to specialize in computer networks and those technologies, then you need to learn more. Okay, not yet. So like we can see, it's a mixed bag, right? Just the basics. So mostly, since most work is now remote, Git and GitHub is being used by most companies because that is how people collaborate these days. So even if you are sitting at home, you know, if you are applying for an internship and if it says on your CV or resume that you know how to navigate around Git and GitHub, then obviously your CV will have a preference over other people because the company will be sure that they can, okay, nice, okay, someone has sent their GitHub profile as well. So yeah, that will give you an upper hand. So that is, yes.
It's not a profile that I made a website and tried to make it, but I'm facing a problem. I'm not able to connect the buttons. Can you see it once?
Okay. Can I, will take this up personally. All right. Because we have a time limit. I have to wind up by 7. So I'll share my contact in the end. All right. You can just reach out to me personally. We can get on call and I'll help you out.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you. We will also check out his website once we're done. So let me just complete what I have planned to tell you. So yes, version control system is important, and also software development lifecycle concepts, how, you know, it actually works in the industry or at a company, how software is developed, what are the different stages. Nowadays, earlier we used to have the waterfall concept, waterfall process. We don't have that anymore. Now we go by agile. So you should look up these terms, try to get familiar with them, because that will actually help you in the long run and also, you know, help you to plan your apps, your websites in a similar way. So I will be sending this document across as well. You can use it as reference. So next, this is just a depiction of, you know, how having those skills that I just mentioned helps you out when you decide your career path. So these are over here three different career paths that we can see. One is a software developer, one is a data scientist, and one is a front-end engineer. Excuse me. So as you can see, a lot of things are common. For example, data structures, if you study, you can use it over for software development. Databases, operating system, again, you can get into this role if you cover those things. HTML, CSS goes for front-end designing. It also goes for back-end designing as well. Version control is important throughout. So I haven't mentioned it repeatedly. And then there are libraries like React, Vue, Angular in JavaScript that are really upcoming. And, you know, people are using these to make their websites. So these are also good skills to have. And in data science, as you can see, we have, you know, diversed into programming knowledge is needed for all of them. So there should be one core programming language that you work with or you're good at. So similarly, when you are sitting down to decide your job role or your career path, list down the job role that you want. For example, you want to be a front-end engineer. List down what are the skills needed in it, and then check back how many you have and how many you are yet to learn. So that way, you will not only just be relying on your college for your education, that way you are taking initiative of your own education. You are working hard, you're researching. And that, I'm pretty sure, even if you don't learn everything, the process of researching and working hard will make you wiser in the long run. You will inculcate more skills, and ultimately, you know, it will really, really help you in the long run. So that is how you should plan out your career path. And lastly, I said I'll be talking about internships. I have only one advice to give. Take some time to upskill yourself, feel confident in your skills, start applying. That's it. You have no idea how many internships I have been rejected from before getting the one I was selected at. So mostly what I have done is, I just like I told you about how to, you know, specify your career path or choose your career path, I used to do the same thing for internships as well. For example, there are platforms like Internshala for India and other platforms. Even on LinkedIn, you get a lot of internship posts. Over there, look at the, they always have this thing mentioned, you know, skills needed. I'll just open a job posting, internship posting here and just show you. So if I go here on internships and if I just click on, for example, this one, as you can see, they always mention who can apply or what should they know. Creating graphics for social media platforms, for the website, identifying trending content ideas. So just like this, sometimes there might be technical requirements also posted. So let's check some other ones out. Let's check this one out. See, over here they have mentioned, right? Adobe Photoshop, Adobe Illustrator, these are the skills they're looking for. So most of the time when you're looking for internships to apply, check out these things, note them down. If you don't have these skills, start learning. Make a few, you know, specimens. For example, if you're in design, make a couple of banners, logos, maybe even design a website, just the front end. And then when you apply, they will obviously ask you, show us your work samples, whatever you have done. So then you can supply those things and it'll make your resume stronger. So that is all you can do. You will be rejected from a lot of them. That is part and parcel of, you know, even as a student trying to learn internships, because you are not a professional yet, right? But since you are approaching it in a planned manner, you're approaching it in a, you know, proper roadmap that, okay, first I'm looking at the skills they want. I am learning those skills. I am implementing those skills by making something. And then I'm applying for these relevant positions. So the chances of getting rejected when you do that is way less than if you just randomly apply, they send you a test, or they call you for an interview, you don't have anything to say and you get rejected. So that is now how you should approach internships. And you know, even 5 years ago, the concept of internships was really, really low in India. We didn't see many opportunities. But now, since you know, a lot of startups have come up in India as well, a lot of them are looking for interns, and there is internship for just about everything you can think of. There is marketing, HR, designing, content writing, even software development, data science, robotics, crypto. There is a lot of work to be there, and there are a lot of opportunities. The only thing that you need to learn is how to apply for them and how to prepare for them. So as this is a roadmap session, so the first step, what I would tell you is to do is upskill yourself, gain some confidence in your skills. Next, start scouting for internships. Don't wait to think that I'll do it in the second year or in the third year. Start, if you're in your first year, start right now itself. Apply to one. If you get rejected, okay, then you have learned what you were doing wrong. And keep applying till you actually land one. Be dedicated. And if possible, you know, these are mostly part-time internships and they don't expect their interns to know everything. Some companies are really good. They're really, really up out there to teach you how to get into the industry, because they also know college doesn't equip us with enough skills to do what we are supposed to do in the work field. So you don't need to be intimidated that they will expect you to know everything. So if possible, they will expect only a small dedication from you, maybe 2 or 3 hours a day. And if you feel confident enough, you can also do multiple ones at the same time. That will also really, really help you to upskill. Because ultimately, your goal is to work at a great company or start your own startup. So to gain this industry knowledge, there is no other way, just to get involved, learn, get your hands dirty, and then come out of it stronger. After every internship, you will feel, you know, the selection process is getting smoother. You're getting more insights on how to speak in an interview, how to, you know, present yourself, because that is also really important, other than your technical skills. So that is how I would suggest and how I have done myself. I have done around 7 internships in my 3 years of bachelor's. So that is how I approached. Initially, I got rejected a lot. Then slowly and steadily, when I figured out these tricks and how to, you know, prepare myself for them, it got better. So that is what I would recommend to you as well. So thank you. And this was all about the formal way. Now I will quickly switch over to what my informal advice is to you. And I'll just quickly reshare my screen. Yes, I absolutely agree with what Sam has said. Learn to deal with rejection. Everyone is rejected at the first time or the other. You have to learn how to take it in your stride. Absolutely. Okay, Preetam asks, what is the best time to get with an internship? Preetam, do you mind me asking which semester are you in?
First.
First, okay. And how much are you? Second, okay. And whatever skills that I talked about, how many of you, like, give me a percentage. How many of you are comfortable with it, or you know it and you are sure of those skills?
I have not learned anything. No.
Okay. So then in that case, I would advise you, take the next 6 months, try to learn. Pick a domain. For example, if you're interested in web development, start with web development. Or if you're interested in app development, start with those skills. And once you feel that, okay, I am somewhat good at it, make a few samples that you can show while you're applying. Then you can definitely start applying for any internship that you like. I hope that answered your question. All right, I will just reshare my screen once again.
Jesslyn, I think Samuel asked you a question in the comment box.
Okay, just a second. Personally, yes. If I am someone who can learn to code, I'm pretty sure everyone says this, but yes, everyone can learn to code, but with the right teacher, with the right guidance, because bad guidance can really make you hate coding. That's what I have experienced from my experience, because just like I mentioned my own experience, I have an elder brother. He was really good at it. So initially when I tried to learn from a teacher, I was not really confident that I can learn it. And, you know, and I personally did not enjoy it too much. I was more of a bio student. I liked biology a lot. I was kind of averse to coding. But then when I actually verbalized this to my brother, and he was like, okay, fine, I'll teach you. You don't need a teacher for that. So my brother is not only really good at it, but he's also a great teacher. So that is when I realized a great teacher helps you to learn coding. It's not about that you can't. Secondly, should everyone learn to code? That also kind of depends. I mean, there is a lot to the world right now than coding, because although it's helping us in coming up with innovations and saving lives, and, you know, a lot of the modernization has been because of coding. We are surrounded by code everywhere. I mean, the fact that we use our phone, our laptops, waking up, everything is very, very technical at the moment. But I mean, no, it's not that everyone should, but everyone should definitely go for something that they love doing, that they're passionate about. And if it's coding, then well and good. And if it's not, then go find something that you are passionate about. That's what I feel.
What about Jasleen, I had a personal question. As you say that we should always keep exploring initially to know which arena we are actually fitting to. So when should be the actual time when we should stop exploring and then like choose the field, like, or else it would be infinite loop of like just exploring and exploring and not having any stand on anything. So what do you think?
Okay, Excuse me. I would also like to add to Santini's question.
Yes.
As we are talking about just starting up, like most of us are just beginners. What I have seen is what happens is we learn a language, we learn the syntax, and we know it's so boring learning the syntax before we get to the fun stuff. So what most of us do is we learn the syntax, then we get bored out of it, so we just jump into the next language. So what advice do you have for that?
Okay, first to address Shantini's question, well, since most of you are in your first year, so if you are planning to, you know, get placed by the end of 4 years, or you are at least expecting to make a decision on what you want to do, your final year, that is your 7th and 8th semester, is the best time to stop exploring and narrow down which company and which job role you want to look at, right? And secondly, see, I have seen people since, you know, this data science and these machine learning fields are very recent. So it's not like, you know, all the people in these fields are new people or young people. A lot of elder, let's not call them older people, experienced people have made that switch, right? They have started learning data science. They have started learning these machine learning algorithms because they want to make that career switch. So that career switch for them, it has come very late, but there are people who are still making it. So it all eventually boils down to, are you enjoying what you're doing? If you make a decision, say at the end of 4 years, that okay, this is, I want to be a SDE1 or a software developer at the end of 4 years, you get a job, you're really happy, you start actually working in that domain. You take a year or two, but maybe towards the end of those 2 years, you realize, okay, maybe this is not really my cup of tea. I'm not really having a lot of fun with it. Maybe if I was just a front-end designer because I like art, I would do better in that. So there is no shame in making that switch after 2 years as well. That is what my take is, because personally, I have seen people do that. From my experience, if I speak, I have seen a lot of my brother's friends do that. I've even seen my father do that. My father started off with the BCom background, which is commerce. He then started learning programming, you know, those old C and Fortran and those languages. He really enjoyed it. So he switched into a technical field. And now totally when he is nearing his retirement age, he does not want to work as hard. So now he's currently into the translation business because it's easy. He's doing the business development role. So he's enjoying that because all these career changes and all these, you know, different jobs has given him a really big connection list, a big networking list. So now it is really easy for him to get these opportunities and convert them into business ideas. So currently for the last 2 years, he has been working as a business development manager. So, and I have seen him happy at every role, but eventually, even if you're not happy, making that switch is not something to be ashamed of. So as a fresher, decide if you're not going for higher education, my advice would be decide in the fourth year, start off with that job, give it some time. If you don't like it, make a switch. If you love it, then you are sorted, continue on that path. So that was about Chandini's question regarding Sanjog's question, that we keep learning a little bit and then switching languages. Well, in those cases, what I would personally recommend is that make projects, make, you know, small programs, solve things, go onto platforms like HackerRank and HackerEarth, where you can solve competitive problems. I was actually going to discuss these in my next part, that, you know, there are a lot of open source opportunities as well, where you can contribute and use these coding skills so that you don't lose interest in this one language and switch to some other technology. Because that is counterproductive, actually, just knowing the syntax and writing a for loop is not knowing the entire language, if you get what I'm trying to say. So only after you build something with it, you will feel like, okay, I know somewhat, you know, 20% of it. There is not a person who is, you know, in the industry who will say like that, I know 100% of this technology. There is no one like that. Yes, learning different technologies is important. But you also have to, you know, stick to some things, develop them to a certain extent. Don't give up before you reach that level where you can actually, you know, prove that you know that skill. So to counter that boredness and, you know, boredom of your language, the best thing is to do is get into a coding community, just like Code Academy. So you guys are set with that. Next, you can do is, you know, go for competitive programming things on platforms like HackerRank, HackerEarth. Participate in hackathons, open source programs. Those things will keep your interest alive. Okay. Yeah, Sam has shared a personal experience as well. Okay, he started off as a geophysics major in 2017 and started with programming in 2018.
Yes, will you please see my problem?
Yes, sure. Yes. I'll just get to that. Yes. So yes, it's okay to have some drift if you must. May not be seamless, but to do it, if it is a process to discover what you truly love. I absolutely agree with what Sam has listed out over here. Chandini, you can totally, you know, take inspiration from that, because that is definitely how you get to know, because there's obviously no certain way to know that, okay, this is what I love. It is a ever-growing process because technology is evolving every day. So it's good to have a plan, but not to, you know, fixate too much on it, because you don't know what life will take you where and what you will eventually end up with.
Yeah, it's always better to have a plan B for a backup.
Definitely.
yeah, we have questions from Srishti Majumdar and Shamadev Guha also, if you can answer.
Yeah, I'll just take them up. Okay, he has a doubt regarding his website, 3D score website, but it's not becoming responsive. What should you do? Okay, like I said, for, I guess it was Manjeet, I will be sharing my personal contact detail as well. We can get together and solve that. Or just like Sam mentioned, you can also, you know, join the Discord server or the Code Academy forum. Everyone there is really friendly. I'm pretty sure if you just post your query with a couple of screenshots and what your problem is, someone or the other will resolve it for you. But yeah, if you want me to do it, I will be sharing my contact details towards the end of the session so we can discuss that. Since it's not really relevant to the session right now, we will discuss it separately. I hope that is okay. And okay, Srishti's question is, C++ good for competitive programming or should I pursue an... Yes, C++ is a good choice. And if you are good at it, then you should stick with C++. I'm just talking about competitive programming, but if you want to expand your skill set into other technologies, then you might consider some latest language like Python or Java. But for competitive programming, C++ is good. Yes, you can continue with it if you are comfortable in it. Okay, Jatin asks, is this necessary to get a college degree like most companies prioritize them over skills? Well, sadly, in India, the scene that we have, you need a degree to actually apply for interviews, but it is changing a little bit, you know, like companies from Tesla and even Facebook and Google in overseas, you know, branches, they are not really prioritizing degrees anymore. They want to know if you're skilled enough and if you're good enough, they will take you. But sadly, in our country, it is still a little difficult to get a good job or a good opportunity if you don't have a relevant degree, because that is sadly the screening process in our country, that, you know, they just screen you based on what you have studied, what's your CGPA. If your CGPA matches the cutoff, then only they allow you if you're going through a college placement. And otherwise, you know, after a couple of years, what I have observed is that if you want to, for example, apply as a freelancer, or you have been a freelancer for a couple of years and then you want to go into a company, that also works. So either a good amount of experience or a college degree is important to get into a good company, especially if you're in India. If you want to apply abroad, there are a lot of companies who are now, you know, changing the whole dynamic, changing the whole system, that they don't prioritize having degrees over skills. So they don't care if you come from a, you know, arts background or a commerce background. If you know coding, if you have done good work in it, they will take you. So I hope that answers your question as well.
B, can I ask you that what do you think is the best way to remain dedicated to competitive coding? Because I have started it and it's like really hard to keep up with it.
Well, in that case, best advice is get a coding buddy, first of all. Don't do it alone, because once you get stuck, once you get an error, but you know, you get stuck, you get demotivated and you leave. So the whole concept of, you know, having these communities is exactly that. Code Academy and, you know, even other communities that are there. The whole concept is to, you know, get together people who want to learn and grow. So maybe just like we saw Srishti asking me about C++, maybe you and Anushka can become coding buddies for competitive programming, learn together, support each other, maybe even, you know, schedule once a week meetups with each other, that okay, maybe on the weekends we're just going to meet for an hour, discuss, do a couple of programs together, like get on Discord or get on Google Meet, mute yourself, start coding, and if you get stuck, ask each other, get help. That is the only way. That is the only way you will not feel alone. And that is the only way, you know, your coding buddy will motivate you that, okay, come on, let's sit down and do this. So even if one of the person is feeling low and they're not really up for it, the other person can motivate them to do it. So that would be my most important tip, find a coding buddy. And if you're struggling with concepts, then obviously there are resources like Code Academy, Coursera, Udemy, where you can go study first, improve your concepts, even just go to YouTube. There are a lot of good YouTubers who post content about these things. Get your basics right, then get back into the game if you feel your skills are the problem. But if the motivation is the problem, best solution is get a coding buddy. I hope I was able to give you some insight. Okay, yeah. but I what Sam said in the chat also, a great profile portfolio obviously always starts from something small. You start off with a basic HTML website, you move on to, you know, creating bigger things, doing other things. Celebrate your achievements, keep learning, keep coding. Yes, that is what my advice to you would be as well. Okay, Devajyoti is really interested in cybersec and embedded engineering. Where can I find, okay, vacancy for this specific interest? Well, I'm not someone from that department, but thanks, Jo. Thanks for attending. Bye. Yes, so I'm not someone who has a lot of experience in cybersecurity and embedded engineering, but what I can suggest is the getting to mentor bit of my presentation. So what you can do is, if you're on LinkedIn, you can try to find someone who is in a relevant field, who is doing the job that you someday aspire to do. Do a good search, find someone, and I'm sure you can get a good mentor who will guide you on how to do that. Regarding scope, right now, what I would say is that, you know, India, since most of the jobs are remote, a lot of people are opting for, you know, remote jobs as well. So there are companies in the US, European companies are also offering jobs to Indians as well. So if you want to worry about the vacancy or the scope, there is scope. If you even apply to foreign universities, you can, you know, foreign universities or, you know, foreign companies, you can even get a job in that domain sitting in India as well if you go for a remote job. So currently, because of the pandemic, the scope and vacancy is not a problem. But regarding finding the relevant resources to learn, I would suggest finding a mentor, or you can message me personally. I'll try to go through my connections, and if I see someone with relevant experience, I can set up a call with you and that person so that you can ask them your questions. I hope I was able to resolve that. Okay, machine learning resources, best is Kaggle. I don't know if you've heard of it or not. Really good website, has a bunch of courses. I'll just drop the link here. So Kaggle for machine learning, deep learning, image recognition, Python. If you want to learn, there are a lot of courses over here. You can just go through the list. I'll just share my screen once again. So they have this whole track as well where they teach everything basically related to machine learning.
Jasleen, Sam has to go because he has a flight to attend.
Okay, so, sure. Thank you for attending, Sam. Thank you. I really appreciate the support.
Yeah, would you like to say,
Yeah, thank you, Asphil. It is an honor to be here. And I, you know, like some minutes into the meetup, I was like, oh, I think most people here are college students. I'm not. Should I leave? But I had to stick maybe a few more minutes to get a hang of it. And I am grateful that I actually stayed. I have learned so much from you, Jasleen, and it was a wonderful experience. So I'm just gonna say one or two things to add up, or, you know, just like just a little bit of comment. And that is, for an individual myself that is coming from a whole total background of having nothing to do with computer science, and in the space of let's say 4 years, I have represented my country in data science, and I am working really great in that field, and, you know, having to move on to software engineering as well. I'm just gonna say that it is possible for you to be whoever you want to be. So I don't know who actually I'm talking to right now and who's gonna take this personally, but I'm telling you, listening to me, that if you set your mind to be the next Mark Zuckerberg, the next whatever, you can do it. And being the best programmer is not the person with the best gear, the person with the best computer, the person with the best, who has all the principles in his head and all. No, best programmers are those people who have that problem-solving skill, those people who are eager to ask questions, who think out of the box. So as long as you do this, as long as you see things differently, you're out to provide solutions to you know, you're not just being an average person. Trust me, you're gonna make huge waves in programming, in computer science. And soon probably we're gonna be reading your book where you're talking about changing the narrative from what we used to believe to something new. Yeah, and also, I mean, if there is something everyone believes, don't be scared to question it. Because when you question what already exists, that way you're certain if you truly believe it and if it's something you should keep working on. So that's just my advice. Thank you very much. It is a pleasure being here.
Thank you, Samuel. I couldn't have said any of that better.
Thank you very much.
All right, I'll just quickly scroll through the chat box to see if I missed any questions. Okay, yes, the Discord link for Shubhnadeep, I'll just drop that. 1 second. If anyone else also has any questions, please feel free to ask. So this is the forum link for Code Academy, and I'll also drop the Discord server link. Okay, yeah, that's the Discord link. And yes, I'll just drop my contact details as well. Just allow me a minute. Yeah, so that's my link tree. You can just click on it and it will show you my LinkedIn and other relevant profiles. So you can add me there or just email me as well. My email is also there. So I respond to emails pretty frequently, and mostly on the weekends I try to, you know, help people other than, you know, the technical stuff and things like that. So if you have any queries or doubts, you can also message me over there. Shantini, do you mind if I take 10 more minutes to just end the session?
Yeah, no problem.
Okay. Yeah. I hope the ones who are present also don't mind. 10 minutes is fine, right? Can I just get confirmation? Yes. Okay. All right. So I'll just list out a couple of community programs that you can be a part of, because from my personal experience, they have helped me grow a lot. So you can also benefit from them. Let me just share my screen. Okay. I hope my screen is visible.
Yeah, it's visible.
Yeah, okay. So over here, just a second. So I just listed 3 things that, you know, no college or course will ever tell you about programming. You will struggle with it. This is just repetition of basically what Sam said. That was completely unexpected. But I really couldn't have said it in a better way, the way he said, your gear does not matter, your level does not matter, you know. It doesn't matter. If you set your mind to it, yes, you can do it. So you will struggle with programming initially. Everyone does. Do not give up. It's coding is something that you love and are passionate about. Do not give up. Or like it says over here, I will haunt you in your dreams. Next, do not expect your college to teach you everything. Learn to self-learn. Self-learning is the best tool. I know none of us are getting to go to college right now. We don't get to meet our friends. Don't get to meet our classmates. It's very lonely and it's very difficult. So instead of, you know, getting into the whole depressive part of it, self-learning can save you from a lot of pain, and it can also help you upskill while you're at it. So 30 minutes a day, that's all I'm saying. Get into that, do it. And lastly, hackathons, internships, open source projects, GitHub projects, online learning platforms and networking are your best friends. Now, what do I mean by these things? So I'm going to list out a couple of programs for you. that you can apply, and that will help you grow in the long run. So for networking, let's start with that. The first and foremost thing I would say, get a LinkedIn account. Really, really important. Add people from your college, add people that you aspire to be like. And one tip, always send a message. When you connect with someone, there's always a pop-up that comes. Add a note, always add a note, write something formal, but also don't make it too long. Let them know why you want to connect with them. Next is having a GitHub account. Those who don't have a GitHub account, you can, you know, at least try, make one, be ready with it. I'm sure your chapter will have more sessions, so you can always learn. There is always time to learn. Next, you should, I'll just make this a little bold. Yeah. Next is a Medium account. So if you're someone who wants to be a technical writer or a content writer, in general, if you like writing, and if you want to document your coding journey, do get a Medium account as well. It is a blog page where you can publish your blogs. You can write about any new skill that you have learned. So it's a good tool to have. And if you are writing about some technical concept that you have learned recently, then you can also, you know, publish it over here. And when you're applying for internships and other things, you can also supply this as your portfolio that, okay, this is my experience and this is my Medium. I usually document my coding journey over here. You can check it out. So that is a good way to have it. And lastly, I would say have a Twitter. Twitter is a really good tool because it has a wider reach. It has a wider reach than Instagram as well. You can contact people on Twitter. People will reply. So Twitter is a good tool to have. So you need these four social medias for networking, essentially. Next, I'll quickly jump on to, campus ambassador programs that you can go for. I have personally been part of 3 campus ambassador programs, met really, really wonderful people. So campus ambassador programs are essentially for college students. I am no more a college student at the moment, so I don't know what I'm going to do next, but you should go and check these out. This is known as a Microsoft Learn Student Ambassador, which I am currently. If any of you are interested to apply to become an ambassador for Microsoft on your campus, contact me. I will help you with the application process. I will try to make sure you are prepared for what you're applying. So that's a really good opportunity, and you can be a Microsoft Learn Student Ambassador as long as you're in college. They give you a swag kit, first of all, which is really attractive to everyone. And they also provide you with Azure credits. So if you want to learn cloud computing, they will help you out with that. And they also give you free access to LinkedIn Learning once you qualify and become an ambassador. And obviously there are a lot of sessions that happens with Microsoft people as well, as in real people who work at Microsoft. So this experience has been life-changing for me. So you should really, really check it out. Next, there is a program called GitHub Campus Expert Program. GitHub is again a child company of Microsoft. So you can also check this out. I won't go into really too much depth about this. I'll just list them out. If you have any queries about any of them, feel free to message me. There is also a Women Tech Makers Ambassador Program that is especially for girls. So you can check that out as well. And there is one popular program by Amazon, which is the AWS Educate Ambassador. So AWS, as we discussed, cloud computing platform, you can check that out as well. So this was all about the campus ambassador programs. Now let me just quickly come to hackathons, or maybe let's go to open source first. So for open source, I would recommend the following things. First is Hacktoberfest. Every year happens in the month of October, so keep an eye out. A lot of new people join in and who are just learning about open source, Git and GitHub. It's a really good first experience for them. I participated myself last year only. I didn't know about it earlier, but it's a really good program. So keep an eye out for this during October. Then there is a program called Outreachy for women. This is for women, so this is just for them. And then there is a Adobe scholarship, if I'm not wrong, that is for women as well. There is a Women Tech Makers scholarship that is for engineering women as well. So you can check those out. And next, there is Hacktoberfest and Outreachy. There is Google Summer of Code, which is for everyone. Google Summer of Code. And then there is one foundation in India, which is the GirlScript Foundation. I don't know if most of you are aware of it or not, but they have their own version of Google Summer of Code, which is known as the GirlScript Summer of Code. So that is also a good place to start off. I have been part of GirlScript myself as the campus ambassador for Bangalore. So they're a pretty good institution. They help you learn. So you can check that out as well, right? So these are a couple of open source programs. Online learning platforms that are completely free most of the time. Online learning. You can check out Udemy. There are a lot of free courses. You can check out our very own Codecademy. A lot of free stuff that you can practice on live coding as well. So that is what makes Codecademy really, 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 really good, because live coding helps you implement the concepts right away. Then there is Kaggle for data science related things. Then there is Coursera. Coursera has a lot of programs from Ivy League colleges. So not all of them are free. So you have to really search for the ones that are. And if you really want to do a particular course, you can also apply for financial aid in Coursera, or you can obviously purchase a certification and do it. And lastly, I would say Microsoft Learn. Microsoft Learn is also completely free. So there are a lot of career paths over there that you can choose. So the career paths will basically help you learn in a guided manner so that you don't get lost and you don't have to plan out that, okay, I have to do this course first and that course first. Similarly, Codecademy also has a lot of career tracks. So you can also check that out. And lastly, there's this website called, this is not a coding platform or anything. It's called classcentral.com. They post about the upcoming free courses and other things, even from Stanford and other places. So you can check out this. And lastly, there is one website called MIT OpenCourseWare. This is the Massachusetts Institute of Technology. So over there, I'll just show you what the website looks like. Completely free. So they have basically made this website for students like us who want to learn. So you can just go here, check out your department, and you can see there are lots and lots and lots of departments you can learn from. You can even learn some other departments if you're interested in that. So this is a good platform to do open source learning as well. And I guess that's about it. Yeah, hackathons. So for hackathons, lastly, I'll just wind up with this. For hackathons, you can check out Hacker Earth, Hacker Rank. There is a platform called Skillenza. And there's also a platform called Dev Community. You can sign up over there. And they also keep posting you about upcoming hackathons. And obviously, if you're using LinkedIn really well, you will see what your colleagues are doing, what your other connections are doing. And if you have interest in any of those things, you can find out about those as well. So that brings me to the end of my session. I hope you found it helpful. I will be sending this list to you as well, in case anyone wants to use it for future reference. So I'll be sending that to Shantini. She'll be sharing that with you.
Yeah, sure.
Is there any question or anything in the chat, Shantini, by any chance, that I missed? I don't think so. Let me just take a... is there a Rajiv here or call? I guess we missed his question. Is Rajiv here? I guess not. Okay, yeah, anyway, that was all from my end. If anyone has any questions, they can ask or we can wind up. Okay. What's all right? Any questions, anyone? I hope it was not too boring.
No, it was amazing to have you, Jasleen. Sanjog would actually have something to say. Sanjog, are you there?
Yeah, I'm here.
Hi, Sanjog.
Hi. So, hello, everybody. So, did you all enjoy today's session? Did you learn something new?
I sure did.
Yeah, we did. Yes. We learn a lot from Jasleen. We are even like planning that she will be happy to take sessions in future with us.
I would definitely. Why not?
So I guess we should wind up now. No more questions. So
I don't see any in the chat.
Okay, so to finally conclude today's event, on behalf of Code Academy Siliguri chapter, I would like to thank Code Academy, first of all, for giving up this opportunity to form a healthy and knowledgeable community. And especially thank you to our guest speaker, Jasleen Sondhi, for being with us here today. And thanks to you for sharing your knowledge. I think it will help us all in the coming years. And thank you all and all present here. I hope you all had a wonderful time and learned something new from this informative session. I hope you all will join us in our future events. And if anyone has not yet joined our official group, I urge you all to. The link is given in the chat box, so you won't miss on any future events. So yeah, once again, thank you all. Thank you, Jasleen.
Thank you, Sanjog. I hope everyone's Saturday was fruitful. I know I took a longer than expected, but thank you for spending a Saturday with me.
Thanks a lot, ma'am, for giving your valuable time explaining.
We're very happy to talk to you.
Thank you so much. I am really happy to be here because I know it's really difficult to start off on your own. So I was really glad when Shantini invited me. So there's my contact detail here. I'll also join the WhatsApp group. In case most of you have missed that link, because there are a lot of links happening, I'll share it once again. And Manjeet and Shomudi, if you have problems, you can contact me personally as well. You can try to sort it out, right?
Okay, ma'am.
Yeah, thank you. Thank you for having me. Can I see a couple of faces? I feel like I'm talking to a screen.
Okay, yeah, let's have a photo session right now. As we always do that at the end of the session.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Riya. Hi, Shantini.
Hello.
I love your background as usual. Hi, Sanjo.
It's always there like that.
I funnily enough, I just finished one painting that I have next to me, and I don't have a place to put it up. It's like really sad. I just saw yours and I was like, why can't I put it up somewhere here?
Wow. What about the rest? Other people are shy. Yeah, Sanjog, you can.
Oh, he also went. Oh, no.
Srishti and Mehnaz, Prasoon.
Don't be shy. Don't be shy. Come on.
Yeah, it's just all of us here. It's okay.
Yeah. Guys are shy. Okay, I guess. Who is taking? Sanjog, you did not open your camera. Own camera.
No. It's open. I can see him.
It's open.
I can't see. Okay. Yeah.
Who is taking? It
is taking a long time. Okay, the rest other people are sleeping, I guess then. Okay then. Thank you so much to come in our session and give all of your valuable knowledge. We'll keep that in mind, and we hope that in future events also you come and give us sessions. Definitely. Every one of us really liked you, and
thank you so much. Enough thank yous now.
Yeah, and I'll be sharing all of your contact details and link in our WhatsApp community.
I'll just send you that whiteboard thing in a while. I'll render that and I'll send it to you.
Yeah. That would be very much helpful.
Okay.
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you so much, guys. Thank you. I'll be signing off now. Please stay safe.
Thank you.
Thank you. Stay safe, please. Take care.
Thank you very much.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Good night.
Okay. Thank you. Good night. And take care.